The crossing analyses of the IT industry and international relations. Welcome to the fourth episode of the revamped edition of the Tech Geopolitics Unveiled. I'm Rocky Yuryankara. Today, we are discussing a question that I have often been asked. Where is the line of scrimmage for the US-China chip war at the current stage? To put it simply, with China's in-house developed chip technology continuing to advance, has it conquered 28mm yet? The crux of the matter is that the US is trying to suppress China, stopping it from building the chips it needed in its territory or buying them abroad. How advanced do these chips need to be for the US to pull out such moves? The US Department of Commerce's Bureau of Industry and Security, BIS, announced a very clear export restriction on October 7th last year, but did everyone comply with it faithfully? Why did the US set the bar at that node level? This question cannot be analyzed only from the political aspect, but also from the technical aspect of the industry. Let's start with the advanced and mature manufacturing processes. There is actually no strict definition of the two, but with the rapid advancement of the chip manufacturing process, it is roughly defined by their nodes, with the smaller number indicating the more advanced. In April 2021, Semiconductor Industry Association and Boston Consulting Group jointly published a very famous report urging President Biden, who just took office in January 2021, not to push for a reorganization of the global supply chain because the expenses could be tremendous. There is a very famous chart in the report, specifically labeling that 92% of the world's sub-10 nm production capacity is in Taiwan, with the remaining in South Korea. This figure, which has made many countries feel uneasy, has been quoted by many politicians and experts, and since then there seems to be a commonly recognized standard, that is, sub-10 nm nodes are advanced processes, and anything above 10 nm, such as 14 nm, 28 nm, 45 nm, etc., are mature processes. But in January this year, TSMC at the investor conference for fourth quarter 2022 financial results, company president C.C. Wei put forward about seven key points. In one of his key points, he cited a DIGITIMES news report, which had marvelous content as most other media in Taiwan did not cover this point, and only DIGITIMES wrote it. What did Wei say? He said that in the next 5 years, TSMC may shift 20% of its production capacity for advanced nodes below 28mm to overseas. Noticing that the advanced nodes he mentioned are actually sub-28nm, why is a 28 nanometers node considered an advanced process by TSMC, which is capable of doing a 3nm1? The two are already several generations away. And where is the overseas he mentioned? TSMC is an enterprise, extremely successful, but after all it is only an enterprise. Facing a whole nation, the US, the world's strongest superpower, the Taiwanese foundry is under great pressure and needs to be careful in responding to its demand. Hence, I believe C.C. Wei's remarks were a response to the U.S. Department of Commerce's export restriction to comfort Western countries led by the U.S. and ease their concern about the geopolitical risks of Taiwan, and so on. For my question asked at the beginning of this episode, which nodes are specified in the export restriction issued by the U.S. Department of Commerce in October last year? Let's take a look at the list, citing from a law firm. We will focus on the first and second points. Both are restricted based on nodes. Let's look at them and read them together to see what nodes they are. The controlled items include the following. First, logic chips adopting FinFET or GAFET 16nm, 14nm or more advanced nodes. Second is DRAM chips made via 18nm or more advanced nodes. The focus today will be on the first and second points, and the third point will be skipped since it is decided on over 128 layers, how many layers to restrict on NAND flash export. This restriction, the restriction of the export, not only does it restrict the chip itself, but also limits the chip's manufacturing equipment. Let us forget about the differences between logic ICs and memory ICs and focus on the nodes' numbers and go back to the beginning of the episode with the question we asked at the very start. The US is suppressing China so it can't manufacture within its territory nor buy abroad chips made via 16 nanometers, 14 nanometers or even smaller. These chips are all targets for US's suppression of China, which is rather clear. But here's the thing. Is it that easy for TSMC and other global chip makers to comply? Or will they find a way to break through? Even in Taiwan, we are also concerned about how TSMC is going to comply, right? Because TSMC is under a lot of pressure from the US. One of the most important concerns of the US about TSMC is that TSMC has a plant in Shanghai and a plant in Nanjing of China, where Shanghai is an 8-inch plant and Nanjing is a 12-inch plant that was built later and has more advanced technology, so we mainly look at the Nanjing plant. Which node does the Nanjing plant adopt to make chips? Well, let's take a look at this chart, which is also a very accurate and clear chart cited from DIGITIMES, showing the evolution of TSMC's manufacturing process technology. Look in the middle. TSMC finished the development of 16 nanometers in 2015, and the Nanjing plant completed its construction in 2016, so the node that the plant has is 16nm, which means that TSMC didn't hide its most advanced technology at the time and had given the technology to the China market. The reason for TSMC to do so? We don't need to think too far. Commercial factors are quite enough since the tech war between the US and China has not started, and Donald Trump didn't become the president of the US until January 2017. The Nanjing plant completed the construction and began production in 2016, while the Trump administration's launch of the tariff war and the trade war, which put ZTE and Huawei on the entity list for various trade bans, both happened from 2018 to 2019 and so on. At that time, TSMC had a major customer in China called HiSilicon, which is the designer of Huawei's handset chips. A single customer accounted for almost 15 to 16% of TSMC's revenues at the time, a really major customer. This indicates that TSMC setting up factories in China is meant to provide services to its customers in a close range, and isn't that also one of the key reasons TSMC going to the US to set up a factory? So it all makes sense. However, with the turn of events, the US and China turned against each other, and TSMC's Nanjing plant is now locked deep in China's territory. So what should TSMC do? Should TSMC continue to push production in the plant with the 16 nanometers node as the foundation? It may all depend on the attitude of the US. In April 2022, TSMC decided to invest NT$80 billion in the Nanjing plant to expand production via an extraordinary board meeting, and guess the capacity of which node had been chosen. A capacity expansion of the 28nm node, and the proposal was then approved by Taiwan MOEA's Investment Commission shortly after, as TSMC, despite its planned investment in China, committed even more investments, which will amount to NT$1.95 trillion in Taiwan over the next 3 years, far higher than the amount given to the Nanjing plant by almost 100 folds. With this, it can be said that TSMC still kept its root in Taiwan, as the most important technology was not shifted out of Taiwan. But why did TSMC decide to produce 28nm chips in China? Remember that 2 years ago, the world was hit drastically by the pandemic, resulting in serious automotive chip shortages. Since chip demand from China also includes automotive ones, and the 28nm node is already sufficient to satisfy the need for producing automotive chips, TSMC's decision is quite reasonable. Because Biden just took office, how far the US would take on the chip war against China was still unclear at the time. TSMC cannot be 100% sure about the outcome, and therefore decided to expand its 28nm capacity, which is broadly needed in the market. However, here I would like to input the saying of some Chinese netizens criticizing the decision. Some of the netizens said that TSMC was using its mature nodes to hurt China's local chip makers. TSMC has deliberately not transferred any of its advanced technologies to China, and when China's chip production industry advanced into the 28nm era, TSMC purposely expanded the related capacity to compete for businesses with the Chinese chip makers that just entered the market. Is this saying accurate? Let's not judge it with nationalist sentiment. Let's take a closer look at where the key lies. Do China's local chip makers have the ability to manufacture 28nm chips? And if so, are their capacities able to meet domestic demand? If not, then what's the reason to exclude others to help you meet the market demand? Because the market still needs chips, and from now to 2 to 3 years later, the problem will no longer lie in the chips, but in the manufacturing equipment. What does it mean? It means that China will have to be able to make the production equipment that can make 28nm chips before they can mass produce 28nm chips. So the question becomes, can China's equipment manufacturers make 28nm chip production equipment? I have first-hand information. I personally went to Shanghai at the end of June to host a seminar focusing on the semiconductor industry. The keynote speaker of the finale was the semiconductor industry legend Dr. Richard Chang, who was born in China and then went to Taiwan, grew up and studied in Taiwan, and then went to the US to continue his education. After graduating, he went back to Taiwan to start his own business and then moved to China to found the number one wafer foundry in China, Semiconductor Manufacturing International Corporation, SMIC. Dr. Chang is 11 years older than me, and most people his age may have long retired, but he is still working tirelessly in the semiconductor industry to fight on. He is the most knowledgeable about China's chip manufacturing levels, so what does he say about it? Although the topic of his speech was the possibility of cross-strait semiconductor cooperation, he mentioned 3 times in his keynote that most of the 28nm production equipment can already be made by Chinese firms, except for the photolithography equipment. He said it 3 times, and I'm simply retelling his exact words as I was sitting right next time to him, as the host and I had heard clearly of his saying and even write notes. I believe his statement should be the most realistic and instant. In other words, the manufacturing technology for 28 nanometers chips is the top priority for China to conquer, and the conquest of this ultra-important strategic high ground is necessary, but with a prerequisite that it needs to be able to produce the related manufacturing equipment. As for the attitude of the US, we have to look at the attitude of the US again, taking into account its thinking and strategy. The US did not ban the TSMC Nanjing plant's 28 nanometers capacity expansion, so what does that mean? It means that the US has tolerated China buying 28mm chips that are producible by local makers. However, some of you may think that the most advanced node now is already 3nm and may advance to 2nm in the next year or two. Since TSMC is already so far ahead, what is so surprising about TSMC doing a 28nm node? We shouldn't underestimate the 28nm node, even though it looks like it is six generations behind the 3 nanometers. Before the episode ends, let me show a picture to explain. Look at the node numbers. It is not necessarily the best if a number is smaller, and it all depends on needs. Let me explain why 28nm is a very important and very efficient node. Let's look at this chart. The horizontal coordinate from left to right is the process node from 99, 65 nm, 45 nm and 50 nm are counted as a group, and then 28, 20, 16 and 14 also counted as the same technology node, and finally 10 nm, 7 nm. This research was published last year. I remember it was February last year. Since it was published in early February last year, 5nm and 3nm had not been put on the chart, but this does not affect our conclusion. Our conclusion is that the smaller the node number is, its costs would dramatically go down in accordance with Moore's law, but when arrived at 28nm and beyond, the production cost can longer go down further and instead climbed a bit. In other words, if you look at Moore's law in terms of cost, it fails after reaching the 28 nanometers node. What does that tell you? If you are a consumer, why do you need the latest technology? Better performance at a lower price to get the optimal price-performance ratio, of course, if the technology is very advanced, but consumers don't have demand for such a high performance and don't want to pay a high price, then it is not necessarily for the consumers to have the most advanced chips. End product manufacturers that are close to consumers also understand the logic and would feel unnecessary to adopt advanced technology for their products if consumers' demand just didn't go there. Then the old technology should be good enough for consumers, fitting right at the spot. 28 nanometers just so happened to be such a node with an excellent price-performance ratio. Its cost is low enough and can meet a large portion of the commercial use of the application needs, enough for China to make a lot of products, such as home appliances, cars, machine tools, and etc. And this node is not what Americans are worried about, since the US is now most concerned about China surpassing it in the development progress of AI. The technology node used for making chips required for AI is far more advanced, so the US has no reason to ban or suppress the 28nm node in China. The above is my observation. Science is about whether it can be proven or not, or even disproven. In the future, we can continue to observe to see the details of the US further export restrictions. We can also monitor the US coordination with the Netherlands-based ASML and Japanese Nikon's microphotographic equipment or photolithography machines and see how thoroughly can their export restrictions of DUV on China be executed. Can the companies offer any repair on machines? Can they continue supplying any of their parts or materials? Will the US extend its suppression to the 28nm node or above? How thoroughly can they execute their export restriction on sub-28nm products? If it is possible for China to make a more refined, more delicate, and more advanced chip with the 28nm node, maybe the US's attitude will change again, and we will find out with our ongoing observation. The line of scrimmage for the chip war between China and the US now lies at the 28 nanometers node, and China, of course, would want to find a way to push the line to 14nm or an even smaller node. So where the US is setting up its defense and whether it can stop China's penetration are all keys to monitor. Some of you may ask, what is the value of bringing this up? The main point is that the US trade restrictions and China trying to break through the US defense are all meant to remove the bottleneck that significantly undermines the development of the semiconductor industry and companies. Let's pretend you are a semiconductor company facing US policies and China's potential business opportunities. If you decide to do business in China to satisfy some of China's demand, then you will be able to continue enjoying growth in operation. However, if you can only follow the US's export restrictions, not knowing how to break through, giving up the China market and seeing sales gradually decline are an inevitable outcome. For us observers that watch the market for a long time, monitoring companies' performances in the industry is also an important view angle. Thank you for watching the fourth episode. We broadcast this program every 2 weeks and welcome your feedback. Please leave your comments and let us know your thoughts. I am Rocky. See you next time.